So who listens to this or watches this?
Nobody. Oh,
my dad.
All right. I just want to know who is. If it's one or two dads, I'm good. I just need to know who we're actually talking to.
We usually have like anywhere from 30 to 45 people, and it's usually like high school, college kids, and some parents.
So some ball players?
Yeah, all mostly baseball players, but like people that are very interested in like learning other, like a lot of our talks are like outside baseball.
Cool. No, that's cool.
Yeah, I don't, to be honest, I mean, in terms of what I was going to throw at you was not a baseball grounded, it's actually not baseball at all.
Because I was a completely below average. I'll struggle with that.
Yeah, Howie, are you on a delay? I can't hear anything.
I'm like glitching like crazy. I don't know what's
going on. We're live, guys.
Wow. Okay.
Jesse's kind of like in and out of mine too. I'm like freaking out right now.
Pablo, you should be able to wait, right?
Steve went off of mine.
We don't hear everything going on. Okay. Steve, talk real quick.
Hello.
Oh, don't do it to him, Papa.
We're live.
So, hey guys, we're here with Jesse Cole. Jesse Cole is owner of the Savannah Bananas and best-selling author of Find Your Yellow Tux: How to Be Successful by Standing Out. You can get it on Amazon, Kindle version $9.99, a steal. $15.99 paperback. I read this book in 3 days. It's one of my favorite books by my favorite person. One of the funniest videos I've seen in a long time. The greatest game ever played in kilts. I'm going to put this on my Instagram page because this just shows behind the scenes look at everything Jesse brings to the table, and it's unbelievable. So again, Find Your Yellow Tux, Amazon. Follow Jesse at Yellow Tux. And we're live. What?
A Yellow Tux Jesse.
A Yellow Tux Jesse. So, Robbie, you want to start us off?
Yeah, sure. First of all, Jess, thanks so much for doing this. This is really exciting. I feel like we've had a string of a lot of baseball dudes. And, you know, I know you can, you know, you definitely can play. It's just kind of cool that, like, we're going to get a perspective outside of someone that's, you know, not playing right now, other than us three who are washed up losers who talk all the time. So, yeah, perfect. So, the bananas and the yellow, like, did you always have a passion for potassium filled foods? Is this something that's new?
That's a really good starting point. Yes, potassium has been my life. No, we have nothing to do with it. I didn't actually have bananas until we became the Savannah Bananas. So I had to own it. But yes, we've gone all out. Now we have a senior citizen dance team called the Banana Nanas, a male cheerleading team called the Banana Nanas. We have Captain Potassium. We have a Team Luchador that only eats bananas. So, yes, we have gone all in on the bananas.
That's awesome. I love that.
Split too, of course. So, yes, now we are all in. But thank you. That's a great starting point. I love this.
So, the past, like, week or so, you know, Steve started off talking about, you know, the process of things. And instead of worrying about the result of every little thing that happens, more focused on the process. And like about having a why, like having a reason and a goal for doing everything, instead of being so focused on, you know, I need to get a single here, but it's bigger than that. And what's the process and what's your why behind every single action? So, you know, I can't imagine when you were, you know, a teenager and you were trying to figure out what you wanted to do. I can't imagine that you said, I want to own a college summer baseball team. So I would love to hear, you know, how you ended up on your path and I guess how it fit your process and like what your why is and what your goal is, I guess, in terms of like what you want to do in life and how that fits what you currently do.
Sure. Yeah. For me, it was simple. I grew up in Massachusetts. My dad bought a baseball facility and baseball was everything for me. I vividly remember visualizing getting a call on draft day. And just getting called, I don't care if it was the 48th round, the 50th round, like I visualized getting that call every day and was fortunate to get a scholarship, played with Steve down at Wofford College. And, you know, I learned I was an average ball. I wasn't good enough to play at that next level. And I ended up getting hurt and that tore my shoulder. And so all of a sudden I had no idea what I was going to do. I had my whole life. That was my process, was play. And I didn't know what I was going to do. So I thought I'd get into coaching. And then I realized when I coached in the Cape Cod League with the best players in the country, every single guy that was on that team got drafted and 15 of them played in the bigs. And I'm sitting there in the dugout with the best players in the country. And I realized something. I was like, man, I love playing the game, but it's not the same as watching the game is not the same. And then I realized at that point I had taken a job to become a general manager of a team in Gastonia, North Carolina, which was the worst team in the entire country. That was the only reason I got the job, because it was the worst. Like, how does a 22-year-old get a job as a general manager? They got to be bad. Like, they're real. They needed so much help. And so I took that job, really not knowing what I was going to do. I was 23 years old. The team had only 200 fans coming to the game. There was $268 in the bank account my first day, and it was a disaster. And I realized at that point, if I couldn't watch a game, if I didn't enjoy it as much, and this team was terrible, no one was coming to it, no one knew who they were, we had to dramatically change what we were going to do. So there was no process to running a baseball team. We just took it and started testing and starting having fun. And really what I said is, could we create something that I would enjoy to watch? How could we make it fun? How could we make it entertaining? How could we make it fun for the players that play, you know, in college baseball, 60 games, then another 50 during the summer, then 20 or 30 in the fall? How do you make it fun for them? And that's kind of where it started, with the craziness, having players do choreographed dances to going on dates with fans during games. I mean, it's an absolute circus now. But what we've learned is the players are having the time of their life. And because of that, they're playing better. And so now we're having so much fun. The bananas, we're fortunate. Every game sells out. We have over 1,000 players that try to play for us every year, and we only can sign 30. And it's been really a dream for me, because I'm just putting on a show and having fun. And there was no process other than you just got to start trying things, just dabbling. I just started trying. And I was like, this is fun. Ooh, let's keep doing this. Let's have grandma beauty pageants. Let's have flatulence fun nights. Let's have salute to underwear nights. Let's just keep trying it and have fun. And that's kind of where it went. And now that's why we keep trying new things.
Yeah, that's cool. Sorry, Steve, go for it.
No, yeah. Speaking to that point real quick, you just did something that I think you guys are maybe the first team in the country at any level to do what you guys just did, and that is to remove all advertising from your walls. Again, I haven't got a chance really to talk to you about this very much, so I'm actually very, very intrigued on what the thought process was there, because you have to be losing revenue, because that's a big revenue, I would assume, maker for baseball team. So what was your thinking behind, and explain what you did, and what was your thinking behind it?
Sure. Everything started for us, and what makes us different. And I think that's for anyone. What makes you different? We start with that. And then for us, it's what are the biggest friction points? So whatever you're in, whether you're coaching, whether you're doing camps, whether you're doing clinics, whether you're running a dental office, what are the friction points for customers? What are the frustrating things? So for us, what we realized is baseball was long, slow, and boring to many people. So many people didn't want to watch it. So we had to make it nonstop entertaining. Then we realized people hate getting nickel and dimed. And so we said, let's make every single ticket all inclusive, include all your burgers, hot dogs, chicken sandwiches, soda, everything for $15. And then we kept going on this. What are those friction points? And then we just kept thinking, we said, all right, does anybody come to a ballpark and want to be advertised to? Does anyone wake up and say, you know what? I want to be sold today. Can someone market me today? I want to be advertised to today. And we're like, nobody, nobody in the world comes to the ballpark to have that happen to them. And if we're trying to create the best fan experience in the world, does that make sense? Then the second question we asked ourselves is, you should never sell something you don't believe in, whatever you do. And I think that's for anybody. If you're really into something, don't sell something you don't believe in, and don't sell something you wouldn't buy. And when we look at what we're doing, we now, and for the group who's listening, 4 years ago, my wife and I were sleeping on an airbed. We were on a mattress. We had an airbed. We had to sell our house. We had to empty out our savings account. We sold 2 tickets in our first 4 months. So we struggled mightily. But what happened is that we realized that we had to kind of go all in on creating this fan experience and do things that we would enjoy as a fan. And so from now, when we were marketing like everyone else, we were failing. Now we spend $0 marketing. And we try to create a great experience where all of our fans tell everyone you have to come to the games, where our players tell everyone else you have to play for the Bananas. So if we're not spending any money marketing, and if we were to spend money on marketing, would we put a sign on the outfield of a stadium? Or would you do something where you could reach more people digitally or put a billboard out there and pay $15,000, $20,000, $25,000? It's not something that we would believe in. You should never sell something you don't believe in. So yes, we threw away hundreds of thousands of dollars. We don't expect anyone to follow suit here. But you know what happened? We stayed true to what we stand for, and that's to create the best fan experience in the world. And when we did that, you know what happened? People from all over the world started reaching out and saying, I'm buying this hat from you guys because I support who you are. I'm buying this shirt because I support who you are. And to go a little bit more on that, we love Netflix. Why? One of the reasons, there's no advertising. You tell me, when you go on YouTube, it's like, oh, great, I get an ad. No, you skip ad. You skip ad. You skip ad. All right? Same thing with Hulu. 15 years ago, no one actually woke up and was like, you know what? Ads are really frustrating. But then you experience Netflix. And my call is that when you go to a ballpark and start seeing ads everywhere, in 10, 15 years, you're going to be like, I'm sick of this. I need more to be advertised to on. They're putting it on jerseys now. Are you kidding me? It's going to be everywhere. They're going to start getting tattoos on people's faces. Like, oh, but Mike Trout's got a new tattoo of Nike on his face. He's getting paid $1 billion a year. He's got the tattoos. It's crazy, but that's where it could go. People don't want it. Don't do what people don't want. And so we're playing the long game on this. We're losing short-term profits for long-term fans. And that's where we'll always go every day of the week. You got me going, Steve.
No, dude, it takes me back to the car rides to Yanni's and whatnot, listening because the cool thing about my perspective of you is I got to see you before you became the Yellow Tux guy, right? And a lot of people may be like, you know, he's a showman, you know, and you're putting on a show all the time. But what's funny about it is this has been you since I've met you, you know, in a Ford Taurus. And to that point, you've always had this, and whether you articulate it or not, you've always had this purpose, if you will, in my words, of being different. You know, if I got to do something, let me do it differently. You know, if I'm doing something the same as everyone else, then I'm wrong. And that's kind of been your heuristic and rule of thumb. Like, where does that come from? You know, like, where did that be? Let me just be different in everything we do. So we have grandma, your first base coach is on the top 10 plays on ESPN because he dances in between innings, every inning, right? You have a breakdancing first base coach. You have garbage can nachos. You gave away all the food for free. Like, everything you've done has gone so different than every other baseball program, but every other business as well. Like, where does that come from? You know what I mean? Like, how did that happen?
By the way, on the first base coach, we're looking at having a mime coach first some games this year where he can't get out of the box, so he's actually stuck. And then we also are in the process of hiring a professional sign spinner. You know, like those people like outside of like Liberty Tax and those guys that sell signs? We're going to hire a professional sign spinner that gives signs at first base, actually gives the signs while he's doing the sign spinning. So we're just sorry. I mean, we haven't announced this, but we also hired an associate coach, but she's a grandma, and she's going to actually deliver cookies to the umpire. She's going to get her a rocking chair for the dugout. All right, this is all 2020 plans, but to get to your answer, being different makes you stand out. And the reality is when you're the same as like everyone else, when you're normal like everyone else, you're going to get the same results as everyone else. And we realized when we were in Gastonia and when we were in Savannah, when we were doing the same things, no one pays attention. And so, yes, I wear a yellow tuxedo because, yes, I am a showman. But if you want to start making a real difference, you got to first have the eyes and the ears of your customers, the eyes and the ears of the people you're serving. So we do things that create attention. I mean, yesterday during obviously this virus, we did put out a video dancing with myself going back to Billy Idol. And we had all of our players, our staff dancing alone in their house. And I'm dancing with a plunger, playing the air guitar. It doesn't make any sense, but it's and people are like, all right, you know, these guys are fun. So, when we work with businesses, we work with people, I ask the question, what makes you different? And I think anybody, individuals too. I mean, you think about where baseball is going. So any of the players that are listening right now, baseball needs more fun. We need more celebrations. Why do people still talk about Joey Bautista's the bat flip? That was what, 6-7 years ago? Because it was fun. People were like, wow, that's exciting. And as crazy as it is, I know you got to play the way it's supposed to be. That's what my dad always told me. And Steve, that's the way I played. But when I see guys that are having fun, when they're doing things different, they actually play better. And this was proven. We actually had a professor come and study our players based on the fun and the atmosphere and playing better. So to answer your question, I think every guy should say, hey, what makes you different? What makes you stand out? Because that's going to make you have better success and have future opportunities to do bigger things when people know what makes you different. And so that's what we question. So every day, whatever's normal, do the exact opposite. No one gets excited about a normal college summer baseball team. Oh, I can't wait to go see the normal college baseball players play a game. I hope they win. Like, no. People get excited to watch our male cheerleading team do the most ridiculous dances on top of the dugout. They get excited for our players to be our ring dudes in the ninth inning, where if you know in boxing, you have ring girls that go like this. We have our players get on the dugouts, rip their shirts off, going like this, and people are throwing dollar bills at them in the ninth inning. I don't know what's happening, but that's what people are talking about. And so that's why we had a meeting a week ago with stilt walkers, fire breathers, aerialists, to actually turn it even to more of a circus. Because again, what's remarkable? The definition of remarkable is, are people willing to remark about your product and your experience? You want to be a remarkable player? Do you want to be a remarkable business? Or do you want to be the same? And we think remarkable is a lot better.
So I would imagine that when you got involved with the bananas, I mean, what you're talking about, like you were talking about get rid of advertising, and you're probably losing a ton of short-term revenue, like you said.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars, yes.
Yeah, so that's a decent amount of money. Yeah. So I would imagine that the people that you work with, some of them had to be like, you got to be fucking kidding me. Like this, like we can't do this. How did you either deal or break through or get through to those people that were on the other side of the fence and saying, we can't do any of this. This is going to kill us completely. Like, how did you manage and deal with those people?
If you're not getting criticized, you're playing it too safe. It's as simple as that. You know, P.T. Barnum, obviously someone just sent me an autograph of P.T. Barnum, like from 1884. And I'm like a big P.T. Barnum fan. He was criticized like crazy. Even Walt was criticized, Walt Disney. You know, again, I think you really got to understand the people that really do things, they're not doing something that everyone loves. If you're really doing something, you're going to piss some people off. And so, yes, we have people that were kind of like, what the heck are you guys doing? People in the industry are really upset with us because we're changing the game and we're changing what it's about. But I think the bigger question is, what do you stand for? What do you stand for? So many people, businesses, they might have core beliefs, they might have a mission, but do you have stories that back up who you are? And for us, it's very simple. Our company is fans first entertainment. Our mission is fans first entertainment. And fans first entertain always. Every decision we make, is it fans first? And if someone can come here, right, advertising on billboards and filling your stadium with ads is fans first, I'd love to have that argument. Let's go, bring it on. Because I don't think it is fans first. And so that's why we'll make our decisions. And so again, it's just kind of that whole philosophy. I mean, in every meeting that we have an empty chair and it represents a fan. And we make decisions for those fans. And so that's just, it's how we run our business. And we want to be the most fans first company in the world. And so when people come to our games, they're like, no, this is for you guys. This isn't to get corporate checks. Here's money. Then you have a responsibility just to those corporate partners. No, we have a responsibility for the 4,000 people that come to our ballpark every night. We have a responsibility for the people that are watching online. We have a responsibility for fans. So that's, without getting too serious, that it's a very simple decision for us. We lost a lot of money, but we gained a lot of fans. And we'll continue to hopefully do that.
Yeah. So
go ahead, Robbie.
No, go for it, Howie. You're up, bud.
Yeah, let Howie once, Rob. Yeah, all right.
Thanks, guys. I was gonna say, like, how do you like know when to make that leap? Like, you know, to make that leap when, you know, to cut advertisements, to, you know, go ahead and make all the food for free. You know, what do you say to the kids who are trying to be different but are afraid to make that leap to do something else? You know,
small
that's
bet. Small bets. Everything's a small bet. We never completely bet the farm on everything. And here's what I mean by that. So, for instance, about 5 months ago, we decided to do free shipping forever and always. And not like, oh, well, Amazon does free shipping. Yeah, you also pay $99 or $100 a year for it. No, we said, let's do free shipping completely. Because again, we think that's a friction point. And how do we make that decision? Like, that's like, we're fortunate. We do merchandise all over the world. But we looked at it, we said, out of all of our merchandise revenue, shipping only accounts for 3%. So if we eliminate 3% and we don't sell one extra piece of merch online, we don't sell anything extra, are we okay if we lose 3% of our total revenue? And we said, yeah, we're fine. But you know what happened in the last 3 months? We've done 40% more orders. We're doing okay.
That's awesome.
The merchant or the advertising, it was about 10% of our total revenue. So if we don't make up the money at all, we lost 10%. That's not a huge, huge bet for us. For most teams, if you look at any college minor league, they're like 40, 50%. They can't do it. And I think if your company is dependent on advertisers, not the actual product itself, you're in trouble. That's a challenge. And so for us, we just made that decision. So for the guys who are listening, hey, if you want to get a little crazy, take a small bet. This yellow tuxedo, as crazy it is, I just wore it at games to start. And then I got asked, hey, could you wear it when you speak? And then I started wearing it in airports when I was going to speak. And the looks that I got, and for some reason, every time at the airport, at TSA, they decide to check me, give me this full check. I dress like this if I was going to do something absolutely crazy, like, are you kidding me? But anyway,
you have to get that guy.
Yeah, you have to get over that fear. Like, here's for some of you guys, anybody that's a writer or whatever. I mean, I wrote 159 blogs before I posted my first one. I was scared out of my mind, and then I posted it. You know what? It was okay. You just got to try things. And so whenever we bring someone on our team, we say, all right, what ideas do you have? And then we have them implement it that day. We had an intern start with us just 2 months ago. And I said, what ideas do you have for us to get better? And he goes, I love how you call every fan and thank them, but I wish you could make it more fun. I go, what do you have in mind? And he goes, well, what if you made it a rap? I go, a rap? He goes, yeah, like a fun rap. And I go, I love it. I go, Austin, you're going to do it today. And he goes, wait, but I'm kind of awkward. I go, perfect. You'll be Austin, the awkward bananas rapper. And all the things, his face is being red. And he's like, really? I'm like, yes, by the end of the day, write a rap and you're going to call a fan, thank them, and do it in a rap. So all day he's working on raps. He's working on raps. He's nervous at this point. At the end of the day, he goes and calls a rap. He goes, hey, this is Austin, the Bananas Awkward Rapper. I'm here to fill your day with fun, joy, and laughter. I hope you enjoy your perch, but I'm here to give you some awesome merch. And he did this ridiculously awkward rap. And he goes, thanks, man. And he hangs up, and he's like, that wasn't bad. I go, of course it wasn't. What's the worst thing going to happen? So now he's Austin, the Awkward Bananas Rapper. He's still an intern with us, and every day he's writing raps. I don't know what else he does. But but you got to just try it. And now that's what he's been a part of. So again, I think the key to get over it is just experiment, just test. We've been studying a lot from Amazon. Believe me, everything they do is they test. And that's how they're coming up with the greatest innovations. Don't be afraid of what's going to happen. The reality is most people are in their own world anyways. They don't really care what the crazy things and different things you're doing.
So there's so much that is so external right now. Like you have Instagram where everything's based on likes and everyone's so interested in views and like everyone's looking at how does the world perceive me. When you started making these small bets and kind of saying, I'm going to be different in every way, did you feel like it almost like intrinsically freed you a little bit? Like, did it change you as a person?
I mean, quantity leads to quality. So when you don't focus on like, I got this big post I got to make, or I'm posting this picture, I got to get tons of likes. What's your next at bat? You know, we're so focused on, hey, all right, here's the thing I'm putting out. If the video with all of us dancing didn't do that well, who cares? We're going to put something out tomorrow. Then we're going to put something out the next day. So we are aware of the likes, comments, shares, views, because that helps us make decisions in the future. We know when the Players did Can't Stop the Peeling music video, and when they did Old Town Road, it had millions of views. We know fans love when our players get in on the show and get on it. That's a test. but we don't make our decisions and don't make our, you know, how we look at ourselves, our perception of ourselves based on how many people are liking it. I think that's a dangerous thing. And so, for instance, I mean, I don't know the last time I looked at my personal views, likes, comments. I respond to my comments, but I don't look at that. Just, hey, what's your next at bat? And for any player, I mean, again, you can get so frustrated. You go for four. What's your next at bat? What's tomorrow? You look at closers and relievers. You know, they always know they got the next day, a starter. And Steve knows this. It was brutal for me. I struggled with this. I'd pitch Friday night, get absolutely shelled. And then I'd be like, I got 6 days till I get to potentially get shelled again. Like, that's tough emotionally and mentally. For us, you know, again, I look at it every day. Let's continue to put things out and continue to test things. And like tomorrow, our whole staff is having a happy hour, virtual happy hour idea palooza. And so we're going to come up with ideas, which we do every month. And it is, what are the things that we can do that are fun and crazy and entertain from our home? So we're going to come up with more ideas and then just start doing them. And that's what makes it fun for us.
So how, I'm going to ask a question I'm assuming that you get all the time. How, and you said something really interesting before about people in the industry were very upset with you because you were changing the game. And obviously you're a disruptor, right? And that's, which is great. And I agree with you. I think I live and breathe baseball and I cannot sit through 9 innings. I don't remember the last time I've watched. I don't know if the last time I've watched 4 innings in a row. It's just so slow and boring. So do you think, like, has anyone ever approached you about running minor league baseball or taking it over to improve experiences and stuff? Or is that something, because it's so, like, you know, old country club-esque, that you don't think that they'd welcome someone like you in there?
You could have gone a few routes there. And I'm going to go also where you didn't go. But here's people in the baseball industry, they don't reach out to us much. We're fortunate to hear from big businesses. And I think the greatest leaders, greatest companies learn from outside their industry. I mean, we just surprised our whole entire team with a trip to Disney before all this virus happened. And we took notes. We came up with so many ideas. We take our company on cruises. You learn from outside your industry. And I think a lot of people in the minor league baseball, yeah, they think we're absolutely too crazy. But what you're saying in regards to 9-inning game and long and slow, yeah, we're going to change the game. And here's the reality of it. Baseball still has a challenge. We know this by watching data. And we're so fortunate. If every game sells out, but still 50 to 70% of our fans are leaving before the game's over, just watch what your fans are doing. So for us, yeah, that's the next big approach that we're going to do. How do you make the game faster, more exciting? And we've tested with players, and we played an equivalent of a 9-inning game in 99 minutes. And the players played, said it was the most fun they've ever had playing baseball. These were college guys. So yeah, that's going to be a next approach to us. And we're going to do in small tests, just like we were talking about earlier. We're not going to say, here we go. Here's this whole big now brand new thing. We're going to test one game at a time. And maybe we're going to do a one city world tour next year and do a Harlem Globetrotters, but one city world tour. And that'll be our big test. And then we'll see where it goes.
Yeah, I mean, that's awesome. And the two key elements that I always thought of you is be different, but also you were never, you know, worried about taking a risk. And I don't think too many people know, and I hope I'm not embarrassing here, but when you came to my wedding, that was, you know, a very risky time in your life to come up to New Jersey and leave what you had going on down in the Carolina. And there's a lot of things going on. And based on your dance moves and everything that night, you wouldn't have even known it. But that was a huge risk that you took, right? And the reward paid off, right? Give me some of those, you know, you can tell that story if you want, but give me some of those big risks that you took that, you know, you were like, oh, I don't know if this is going to work, but hell, let's do it. Because you're talking about little bets and you're talking about putting yourself out there. And I know you do that all the time. So what are some of the big ones that you're like, hey, this is it. Let's see if we can do it.
Yeah, and I love how you referenced my dance moves, which are absolutely ridiculous. So I was probably doing a lot of that today, and that's just always happening no matter what. Yeah, what you're referencing, I remember it vividly. I was in the hotel room with Emily. It was 4:45. Your wedding was on a Friday night, January 15th. And I remember that. All right. Yeah, I know when your wedding date is. You don't even know.
I literally wouldn't have known that. Thank you.
I feel so happy, Christine. It's just terrible. So 4:45 on a Friday. One of our teammates, one of our staff members called us and said, we just overdrafted our account. We were completely out of money. And this was 4 months into it in Savannah. And so me and Emily look at each other and like, we're about to take the bus to go to your wedding. And we're like, holy crap, like our company is done. Like we just back on it. And so we go, and that's probably why I was dancing. I probably had a little too much to drink that night. But I the next day, or when we drove back from New Jersey, and no offense guys, but it was very gray and it was probably raining. And we were driving, and Emily turns and she goes, we gotta sell our house. And she goes, we have no other options. So we sold our house. The next day, we emptied our savings account. We put the money into the team. And then we got an airbed down at this absolute dump down in Savannah. And, you know, looking back, everyone says, how do you go about doing that? And for us, there was no other, like, decision. Like, it wasn't as scary as it sounds. It was like, no, this is what we have ahead of us. I think people often fear, you know, the big failures and what's going on. Like, no, this is the next project that we have ahead of us. And so we're going to go in and we're going to go all in on it and put everything in. And I think you look back, you know, Jeff Bezos said this best. He goes, when I look back at 80 and am 80 years old, you know, would I regret not doing something? And he said, I would have regret not getting into the internet thing back in 1997 and seeing what it would be like. And so we would have regretted not going down to Savannah and trying this crazy thing with the Savannah Bananas. And so we could have given up and just gone back to what we were doing. So that's how we did. That's what we did. And obviously we created attention and created fun and it worked out. To answer your question about how do you go into or how do you make those decisions, is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I mean, in a sense, you know, like you said, I have to sell. I mean, this is probably a little bit outside the scope of what our some of our listeners even can fathom. But hey, we got to sell our house, right? And put every single dime of our savings into Savannah. And you know, Savannah just had a minor league team fail, right? Like they just had a team that got like, you know, left the city because they weren't successful. Mm. And now you're coming in. How do you know, all right, well, I'm going to take this risk and we're going to bet on ourselves. You know what I mean? Like, is there a thought process behind it? Or is it just like, I believe in myself to my core and our product and we're going to do it?
So our small bet was the team in Gastonia. So What we realized was in that city, once people knew what we were doing, it took off. Once they knew that this was, wow, you know, we could watch the players dance. We could watch all the shenanigans and the fun and them giving away Porta-Johns and colon cleansings during games. When they started seeing that and not knowing really what's happening, and we created this mindset of, hey, if you don't come to the ballpark, you might miss something. Expect the unexpected. And people started talking about it. We said, all right, it's not working in Savannah now because people don't trust us. They don't know who we are. We have to get attention. We have to create the attention. So our small bet was that. And so, I don't know. The question I get asked a lot about is failure. And how do you deal with failure? And what are your thoughts on failure? And I don't think about failure at all. To me, it's, you know, failure is discovery. You know, the reality is like, what are we discovering every day? And I heard, again, someone said, you know, we don't play to win, we play to learn. And so it's like, hey, again, what can we learn today? What can we figure out? Sarah Blakely, who invented Spanx, I heard a story about every day when she was a kid, she'd go to the dinner table and her father would say, what did you fail at today? And because they wanted to teach, what are you actually trying? And if you're not trying things that are hard, then you're actually not moving the ball forward and not actually. So for us, we just, Steve, it's so tough to answer because for us, we just believed in it and then kept doing it and didn't even look as failure as an option. And I think if you eliminate the idea of failure in your mind and just say, hey, let's try it and let's learn something from it, you'll try a lot more things.
And before you said, that you learned a lot from different avenues of business, I guess. Is that fair? Is that what you said?
Learned from tons of different businesses, yes.
Yeah, so your podcast, you do a podcast called Business Done Differently, and it looks like you have some guests of like all different backgrounds and stuff. Do you ever get ideas from them that you end up like implementing onto your business side?
No, what I do is I interview them, but I mute them so I can't hear it. So I actually don't listen and don't learn at all from them. It's very weird to call them. It doesn't really work that well.
I was sending you a softball question, Dick.
No, yeah. I mean, on purpose. You know, people say, why don't you start a podcast? You know, what were you thinking? And I was like, for me, it was connecting and learning. And I didn't even think about how many people were listening to it or how many people watching it. It's a different mindset because you have a different goal for everything. I knew 5 years ago that if I want to grow, the ceiling of our company is how much I'm able to grow. And I say that to my leaders too. If we want to grow as an organization, it's dependent on the growth of our leaders. And so for us, you know, talking to some of the biggest, the most best-selling authors in the world, the biggest entrepreneurs, billion-dollar companies, I'm learning from them tremendously every single day. And Steve, I do want to jump on one thing before that. Just remembered, you know, I think everyone thinks like, what if it fails? Well, what if it works? you know, we ask that question, what if it works? And I think that's constantly, we don't ask what if it fails. So it's different a mindset than you say, what if it works? Then it's different. And so that's how we approach everything. Like, what if this actually worked in Savannah, Georgia? What if people went nuts and went bananas for this crazy team? What would happen? And that was our mindset. Not what if they fail and what are we going to end up on an airbed again, like a smaller airbed, which by the way, Emily, when she bought the airbed, she wasn't the best purchaser of this. She bought a twin airbed. So it's me and her, like, just absolutely like it. We couldn't even lay on it. It was the worst. But yeah, anyways, that's an aside, but that's kind of the whole mindset on everything. So yes, I do learn from other people constantly, and we're constantly asking what if it works. And that's how we approach everything.
What are some of your biggest, we have a lot of college guys that message me all the time about, cause they know that I know you. So they're like, yo, you got to get me on this bananas team because everyone wants to play in front of a sold out stadium every night. And you know, the energy that you guys bring and all that stuff. What are some of the biggest, I'll say, attractions that you've seen that have had success? You've named some of them, but what are like the ones that you're just like, this one killed it. Like this one is our go-to. You know,
you mean for like different promotions?
Yeah.
So, I mean, every single night the players do a choreographed dance. We have your favorites. So like we have 150 different promotions that we do a given night. We add 150 that we do throughout the year, and we'll add about 50 new ones this year. The things that always happen, our players would do a special choreographed dance, whether that's Britney Spears and they tie up their jerseys. I mean, these are actual college players, guys that actually get drafted do this. To our breakdancing base coach dances twice a game. We'll do dancing in the dark where we blindfold people on the field and they think they're doing a dance off, but then we take everyone off and it's just one person by himself dancing in front of 4,000 fans. we do guess your spouse, where obviously we blindfold a woman and we have four gentlemen and she has to touch everyone's butt and figure out which butt is her spouse's. That's politically incorrect. Turtle versus toddler. We have a turtle mascot race, toddlers, all that are about 1 year old. And it's the world's slowest race. So we play Chariots of Fire theme song as these toddlers are slowly moving against a turtle. It's all about, we think of it as a movie and an arc. So for instance, the ridiculous, the fun, and then we also think about the poignant moments. Like players in the middle of the game will go into the crowd, drop down to a knee and deliver roses to little girls. Then an inning later, the players will go on dates with fans. So we set up literally a dining area and we have food delivered. We have our sexy saxophone player, which yes, we have a sexy saxophone player that will play as they're in the middle of the game having a date. So like our full pep band. Yeah, we have a 20-piece pep band that plays when people come into the ballpark, plays when they're leaving. We have Olga, who, if we're winning by a couple runs in the eighth inning, we have a singer intern who dresses up in this giant fat suit, and she sings on the dugout because it's not over until the fat lady sings. So, and that happens. Our coach always, Tyler Gillum, our head coach, goes, Jesse, you're killing me, because we're doing it in the middle of the game. It is so bush league. Like, we're singing in the middle of the game that the game's already over. But it is. The reality is we're constantly thinking, how do we make fans feel? So in the fifth inning, we get the whole stadium standing and dancing, Hey Baby. Then we do a sing-off where we have 2,000 people in one grandstand singing against 2,000 people in the other grandstand. When the song stops, everyone sings and they're standing and going crazy. You're trying to create an experience that people feel like they're a part of. Baseball being a spectator sport is dead. Next time, whenever baseball starts up again, watch an inning, but don't watch the game. Watch the people in the seats behind home plate. And less than 50% are actually watching the game. They're sitting and they're on their phones. They're talking to other people. We want to get people so engaged, so energized that they're like, this was the most fun I've ever had at a baseball game. And so that's kind of the approach that we take. And it's a ton of fun. Cause we always ask, like we say, would we laugh at that? We put ourselves in our customer's shoes, which we actually do. Every single game, one of us go undercover. I take off the yellow tuxedo one game and I park with the fans. I walk in with the fans. I sit with the fans. And I experience it with the fans. By the way, our rival is Making Bacon, as was referenced earlier. And we have Making Bacon urinal cakes and all the men's urinals on our rival. So we try to think of everything that's pretty fun. And we hired a 6-year-old professional high fiver, and he's got a jersey that says hi and his number is 5. and his sole job is to high-five every fan in the stadium. And we actually pay him, which means we break every child labor law in the book. But that's awesome. His job. So every game between 2,000 and 2,500 high-fives. So again, it's all about creating these remarkable experiences. So when the players come, they're like, you got to be kidding me. The first practice we have practice. I go, guys, we have a whole orientation. We show videos. We get them into the show. They do a music video. And I go, guys, we're going to have practice tonight. There's going to be 3,000 people that show up for practice. They're like, get out of here. I go, all right, guys, it starts at 5. I'll take you out at 4:30. They're like, why at 4:30? I go, you'll see. And the line is going all the way down into the parking lot to watch them practice. At that point, they're like, this is real. This is real. And they know what it's about. And I go, guys, they're here not just to watch you. They're here to be a part of the experience. And how are you going to create amazing fans' first moments? And that's why our guys do things like when a kid asks for an autograph, a player will come up to him and a kid says, hey, can I have your autograph? He goes, only if you give me yours. And our players actually get autographs from all the kids on their sleeves, on their hats. And it's all about creating those moments. And I think that's what a long, long answer to what we're trying to create at the ballpark.
Jesse, you and Rob remind me so much of each other. It's really unbelievable.
Is that an
That's you take it out.
Howie signed off. Howie's out.
I got a phone call. I'm back.
All right, go on.
So you take that however you want. Yeah. Rob is one of the funniest people I've ever meet. He's very creative.
And he's wearing yellow,
yes. So like you guys come up with these things so quickly. You're so witty. You know, they're right on the spot. Like, is it nerve-wracking knowing that like one of these ideas that you have might not work?
Oh.
Or they might fail?
Every single night. The last game of the year, we did Living Pinata. We put an intern in a turtle costume, and we had kids with plastic bats hit him on the field while he threw candy up in the air. Fans were like, what the heck are you guys doing? All right? That's like we did cold turkey where we actually got giant 15-pound turkeys. We took them out of the case. And we ran two grown men on the field, and we said, all right, guys, you have 2 minutes to make them as warm as possible. It was the most disgusting thing I've ever seen. It was the most unsanitary thing we've ever seen. That's the first and last time you'll ever see that, fans. But what we think about is these ridiculous things create stories, and they create more of the fun. And our fans are like, wow, you guys are willing to try anything. And that's why, like last year, like for Thanksgiving, we said, all right, let's have a Fansgiving game. And we actually got our fans to show up, and we had 20 fans dress up in full pilgrim costumes. And we had the first ever baseball game that never was, because that makes no sense in the 1600s. So we threw out a first rock. It was the Plymouth Rock. All right. Instead of throwing out t-shirts, we threw out bread. And our announcer's like, who wants rations? We're throwing rations into the crowd. And we threw pieces of bread. And none of it made sense. But if you look around, you see people laughing. And I think that's, you know, that's what it's all about. I mean, you guys get me going for a while. I mean, the reality is like last year we dressed up a person in a priest costume and dressed up another person in a big Jimmy Dean son costume. And it was our father's son catch before the game. And so, everyone loves the kiss cam. You know, everyone loves the kiss cam. But we don't have a video. We have an old stadium, 1926, no video scoreboard, no suites. So we had this big bearded intern. And we said, his name's Ricky. I said, your name's no longer Ricky. He goes, what do you mean? I go, you're Cam. In every game, you're going to go through the crowd, and we're going to have people kiss you. And so we started doing the kiss cam. Here comes Cam for the kiss cam. And people are, do I really have to kiss this bearded guy? And we would get with the camera, and they had to kiss him. And that became the kiss cam.
The entire town of Savannah now has herpes for that, so that's great. Whatever gets it done, yeah. I think no one would ever fault you if you said, listen, like, you know, the off months of non-summer, like, we make so much revenue in the summer, and then the off months are really tough. How do you fill those months with, like, fan experience? Like, you were talking about Thanksgiving, like, how do you fill those months, and are people still really like involved even in the off months that isn't the summer?
Yeah, I think it's a challenge with any seasonal business. But you know, for us, it's very simple because our mission is fans first, entertain always. So we ask, how can we entertain in the off season? And so, like right now, especially when everyone's home, you know, we announced the first Bananas game of the year on Friday, and everyone got fired up, and they were like, "Let's go!" I'm like, "Guys, what are you doing?" And like everyone's fired up, and then all of a sudden, I see my team on a Facebook Live and we've got our VP in a full suit. Fans, welcome to First Bananas Game, and our guy's playing a video game versus the Macon Bacon, but thousands of people watching. I was like, I think you upset some fans, but I was like, hey, it is what it is. I think big picture, if we want to grow, because we have, you know, I don't want to say maxed out, but we sold every ticket to every game, and we will look at how do we bring take the show on the road. And how are we going to start having different tours, starting with the One City World Tour, and how to start bringing this show to more people. So that will be our next step. And so whether that's a fall tour, a spring tour, we're going to start experimenting. And I think it's going to be fun as hell because you know what? It should fail. It should fail. There's a reason why there's only one traveling sports team in the world. And it's the Globetrotters. Everyone else failed. And the Globetrotters have been doing it for almost 100 years. So everyone would expect it to fail. The logistics don't make sense. Paying for players, the cost, going into it, travel. But that makes it fun. Can we make it work? And, I'll put some money on it that we will. We'll find a way.
That's awesome.
Well, to your point about creating stories, I think one of the biggest stories, I mean, we've had a lot of stories in our relationship to date, but one of the ones that we thought was the worst at the time that turned out to be like a story that I share with everyone was your wedding. And you were going to be married on the baseball field, right? We were all going to be introduced like a baseball lineup. You were going to come out of the bullpen riding on the mascot, right? Like that was going to be your entrance.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. And the day of, we get there and it is torrential, like hurricane rain. Right. And I wake up scene and I said, well, you know, I guess we're going to have to, you know, scrap Jesse's plan of having a wedding on the field. And Jesse Cole said, no way, we're going to do this. We're going to do it on the damn field. And you wound up getting married on the field in torrential rain. And we all had to walk everyone with umbrellas, but everyone was soaked. You had 13 best men and it was unbelievable. That negative has turned into this positive of a story, right? So, like, has there been anything in your time in either Gastonia or in Savannah like that, where you're like, well, that was really negative, right? Like, at first, it looked like this was bad, and it turned into, like, oh, my God, that was awesome.
Yeah, thanks for bringing back to that rainy pour. I mean, literally, everyone lost their shoes, their yes. Pants. They just left it on the field. It was like, these aren't going to be good ever again. Another experience. I think about events like a Tap of the Morning Beer Festival, where we decide to have a beer festival at 9 a.m. because you can't drink all day if you don't start in the morning. And so we developed that beer fest. We're like, all right, this is so dramatically different. People are going to come. And all of a sudden, like a week before, we've sold like 37 tickets. I'm like, guys, this doesn't look too good. And so we improvise. We're like, what if we give everyone free breakfast? And it was like, all right. So I start calling breakfast places like, free breakfast, first 150 people. And so all of a sudden, we had like 150 people show up in line ready to rock and roll. So it looks like this huge 150 people ready to come in. And I think that was about it who showed up. But boy, they had a lot of fun. All right, 9:30, 11. And but what happened was we actually eliminated the afternoon beer festival and we just did the morning. And the next year we brought it back and we had almost 1,000. And so, you know, the thing is when you do something for the extremes, you know, people, what's the story? Oh, I went to a beer fest. That sounds fun. I went to a beer fest that started at 9 a.m. All right. I don't mess around. And we had all the stories that were fun. So again, I think for us, it's like, hey, let's try something with a small group and see what happens. So yeah, a lot of things. We did a Midnight Madness baseball game, which with our former team that the owner said, Jesse, I think you're absolutely crazy. We're going to lose a lot of money. And I said, well, what if people actually do show up? It was almost kind of like an experiment. What if people show up at midnight? And he's like, that won't happen. But, you know, you've done some other things right. We'll give it a shot. And so what I did is for weeks before, I called every manufacturing company that has three shifts and all the people that get out at the second shift at 10 o'clock. I was like, they're going to want something to do. And I got a few companies to buy a lot of tickets. And I remember him showing up at 10 p.m. that night to get ready for the game. And he sees this huge line waiting outside to get into the ballpark. And he looks at me, he said, Jesse, you had the biggest shit eating grin on your face. Look at me. You better believe I did. And so it turned out to be a pretty good success. And I think that's a good challenge. I think it's a good challenge for people to say, hey, you know what? I don't know if this will work, but you know, I trust you, go get after it. And I think the idea of having something on your shoulder that you have to prove, I love when we do something that people say it's going to fail. We had so many people that say, hey, your no ads is not going to work. You're going to raise all your prices. So I immediately said, nope, all our prices are the same. You know what? Maybe we'll lower some prices. All right. And I look at that approach. People say, hey, that travel won't work. All right, bring it on. And I think all of us, we need a little bit thing on our shoulder, a little thing that we're going against. And if you're doing things like everyone else, you're not going to have the people that are questioning you. I love when people question us. When we first named the team the Savannah Bananas, we got so much hatred locally. Nationally, people are like, oh, you guys are awesome, because they don't have to like that's their city. Like, they're like, these idiots, Savannah, go Bananas. You know, they're having fun. But locally, you're like, this is our city. What are these idiots doing? And so we got emails and messages like, the owner should be thrown out of town. You guys will never sell a ticket. You're an embarrassment to our city. So what did we do? We actually saved every single one. We printed them out and we kept them. And a year later, after we sold that every game, of course, we did a mean tweet video, which you can see on YouTube, of us reading all of the hate emails with our whole staff. And what we found out was half of those, they've been to buying season tickets and buying ticket plans with us. So, hey, it just became a lot of fun for us.
That's awesome.
When we see so many high school athletes and, you know, when we talk to them about what do you want to do with your life, and, you know, so many of their answers revolve around money and some type of financial answer. As someone that, you know, to be honest, you don't look successful because you're dressed in all yellow. But other than that, I mean, I wish you would adopt me. But I think, what would you say to those kids that their answer is like, I want to make a lot of money, or I want to be successful and have a big house? Like, what, in terms of like, if they wanted to be an entrepreneur or get into business or anything, what would you say to them that are so strictly focused on the financial aspect of things?
I get it. I would say, I understand. I was like you as well. And I completely understand. And as someone that's younger, I think the idea of making a lot of money is what to many is the definition of success. But as you get older, as I've learned, my definition of success really has very little to do with money. My definition of success is freedom and fulfillment. The ability to do what I want, when I want, with the people I want, and to do something that gives me purpose. And so for me, I started as an intern, an unpaid intern. Then I got paid as the general manager, a GM of a team, $27,000 a year. And I couldn't pay myself the first 3 months because there was no sales, there was no ticket revenue, there was no sponsorship. But I loved coming to work. I loved it every day. I was like, this is fun. This is a challenge. It never felt like work. And then all of a sudden we got pretty good at it. And I'll never forget, after my first year, the owner of the team, Ken Silver, who was a big mentor for me, he said, at 24, he said, hey, Jesse, you doubled the revenue, doubled the ticket sales, did everything. He goes, whatever you think your salary should be for next year, you do it. And I was like, 24 years old, I get to name my own salary. And I was like too scared. So what I did is I was like, I'll go to 40,000. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to double the revenue again. He's like, done. And so from that point on at 24, I started dictating my own salary. And you know what? When you get to a certain level, whatever it is, and it could be 40, 50, 60, 70, really doesn't matter. If you love what you're doing, you enjoy it, the money ends up taking care of itself. And for us, as we lost, we had to sell our house, empty out our savings account, it's worked out okay afterwards. And I think if you start chasing money, you're going to start sacrificing enjoyment, passion, and love. So I would challenge kids, hey, don't be afraid about an internship. Try things, experiment. You'd rather be happier for 8 hours a day doing what you love than have a big paycheck, but hate going into work every day. And that's what we teach with our people. And we talk to them always. And I'll tell you, our people, we let them dictate their salary a few years ago. They're involved in profit share. And they were making very little when they started. And now they're all doing pretty well. And I think that's when you build a good company. And that's what you should be a part of. And I would challenge any of these people, the young people, like, find a company, find people that you admire, that you want to work for, that you want to be a part of. Find people that you can learn from. Don't just look, hey, here's 50,000, 100,000, whatever that number is. It doesn't matter. You know, think about what you learn at 23, 24, 25. That's the most important. And I was able to learn so much because I had the empowerment to be able to try ridiculous things every single day. You're getting serious there. That's a serious question, Rob. So, you know, I'm talking about crazy things. You're getting serious. We can go there.
No, I mean, that one actually hit home for me. You said 23, 24, 25, sitting with people who try to learn from. that's me.
You said a lot of really, really, you know, stuff that transcends the baseball field, which is what I knew you would. And that's why I really thank you for coming on. I mean, it's awesome. Yeah. I've been your best friend for years now, so I've got to see behind the scenes. I got to see this develop, and I'm just so proud to be, you know, a very, very, very small part of it. But the thing about you, and I keep saying different like key pieces about who you are come through in the business world. You know, you don't change. You're Jesse, no matter whether you're wearing a yellow tux or whether you're at my wedding getting drunk on the dance floor. One of the big things that you did, and you've mentioned it a bunch here, is you've never been like afraid to take a chance, and you've never been afraid, like, what's the worst thing that happens? Like in college, and I don't know if anyone knows this, you made your own damn major. Like we went to a very good college in the South. Like it was a prestigious college, kind of uppity, right? And I was a finance major. Why? Because I thought that's just what you needed to do. And I remember you being like, I don't know what I really want to do. So why am I going to pick a major? And you're like, I'm going to pick my own major. And I was like, what the hell does that even mean? And you wound up going and arguing to develop your own major. And it was, you developed it. Like you made your own curriculum. You did everything. And you graduated with a degree in basically a Jesse Cole made major. Again, it's not so much about like the major, it's about you just saying, what was the worst that was happening? What's the worst thing that could happen by walking into the dean's office and saying, this is what I'm going to do? You know what I mean? And I think that, you know, is so important for all of our kids and all of our listeners out there that, you know, taking chances, like you said, everyone looks at the downside of it. They don't look at the upside of it. You know, what's the worst things that happen, but what's the best thing that can happen? You know, what are the learning opportunities that I can develop from it? So I just wanted to again, say thank you for being here tonight, man. I think everyone that is watching this right now is better off for having heard it. And I can't appreciate it enough. So
appreciate it. Well, again, if something frustrates you, don't be afraid to change it. Don't be afraid to try it. And I didn't, you know, taking calculus classes to get a business major. No, thank you. That's not what I want to do. So I decided to change it. I'll leave with this, Steve. When I think about you and I think about our times, I think about just the ridiculous laughter, just actually laughing so hard in River. When I remember the pranks, the jokes, the stories that we would tell of the nights before, and just outrageous laughter, the messages we would send each other on Facebook afterward. Yeah. And I think for all the guys, when you look back, and I can leave with this, look for more laughter. Look to laugh, man. And I think we need more of it, especially now. And don't take yourself too seriously. That's the biggest thing that I try to pride myself. We take what we do seriously, and that's giving fun. But the reality is, don't take yourself too seriously. You'll always remember the laughter, the fun you have with people. Just like this, I can tell you guys have a lot of fun doing this. Do more of that. And for the young guys listening, hey, find that. That's where it's at. And don't worry, the money, everything else will take care of itself.
That's awesome, brother. Well, again, thank I appreciate you. It. And hopefully everyone gives you a follow and follows up with you.
I appreciate you guys.
Thanks so much, man.
Thanks, Jesse. Thank you very much.